Hi everyone, welcome to Moving Automation Using APM. So basically the pic over here depicts the basic architecture of APM. APM is similar to Selenium. It has open source as is Selenium is, and it uses the JSON wire protocol like Selenium does. And it is APM is a wrapper over the Selenium API, and also it includes various frameworks used for automation and is provided by different vendors like instrumentation or UI automator framework and UI automation 2 or XUI test. Here the various automation frameworks for mobile which have been provided by individual vendors like Google, iOS, etc. So APM uses or wraps up all these components and it is built on top of these things. So what are the components, various components that will be used or utilized in APM? You can see over here, APM is also like similar to Selenium, which is based on client server based architecture. So APM has APM client and APM server. So similar to Selenium, where Selenium client is based on various bindings, different bindings, language specific bindings. It is not based on a particular language, it is not dedicated to particular language. Similar to that, APM client is also not dedicated to particular language since it is based on JSON wire protocol. As JSON is an interoperable language like XML, any client that is written in any different language binding can be able to communicate with the server. So for example, you can see over here, APM server is built on Node.js. And APM clients are available in different language bindings like PHP, it is available in JavaScript, it is available in Java, it is available in C#. So we can choose any client, any language specific client. That is, you can write code in any language like PHP, JavaScript, Objective-C or C# or Java, and it will be able to communicate with the APM server which is written in Node.js. And then what are all the commands which were developed that was based on the web driver protocol? It will be communicated over JSON wire protocol to the APM server, and APM server using instrumentation framework or the UI automator framework for Android applications or UI automation 2 framework for Android application, Android based devices, it will be able to automate the things. On the particular device, and also it will be able to do the same work using the XUI test or UI automation 2 on iOS devices. So what are these instrumentation framework or UI automator framework or UI automation 2, UI automator 2 or XUI test? So these are the frameworks that have been provided by different vendors like Google and iOS, such that we will be able to automate the apps related to different vendors. So different platforms, iOS platform or Android platform. So APM server using this, APM server will be able to communicate to the platform, different devices, Android device or iOS device using these instrumentation frameworks or UI automator framework or UI automator 2 framework or XUI test framework. But basically, instrumentation and UI Automator 2 or UI Automator framework are used for Android devices, or Selenroid framework is used for Android devices based on the level, based on the API level. If API level is greater than a particular thing, then it will be based on Selenroid, or if it is greater than a particular level of API, then it is based on UI instrumentation framework. UI automated framework too. Similarly, it is the same concept that applies to even iOS related platform. So this is the basic overview of APM, and let's see what are the topics that we will be covering as a part of this video. So first we'll be looking at basic introduction on APM. What are the various components that will be as a part of APM, and we'll be looking at the definitions of those things, the APM concepts, what are the different concepts that are available. And as I told, there are vendor specific frameworks available, and those specific frameworks we'll be looking at, and who provided different frameworks, what are the different frameworks that are available. And then we'll be looking into the APM architecture in detail for Android separately and iOS device separately. And then we'll be looking into APM workflow. So when we execute a script in a Java specific binding language, then how the script will be executed on APM server using APM server, and it will be communicated using the Cylindroid or UI Automator framework, and it will be executed on the particular device, Android device. So we'll be looking at how this happens. What are the various things that happens while in this entire workflow? And then we'll be looking at the various inspectors that are available, and what are the inspectors we'll be choosing for inspecting the web elements on the application. And then what are the application specific files that will be pushed or installed to the mobile? What are the basic requirements or the basic things which we'll be requiring? And then we'll be just looking into the mobile JSON wire protocol specification. As I told, APM is also based on JSON wire protocol specification, and we'll be looking into that. And then we'll be looking up the looking at mobile application types, like the app types, whether it is a hybrid app, what is a hybrid app, what is a native app, and what is a mobile web app. So we'll be looking at all these things. And one more thing specifically we need to mention over here. APM client is required only for native or hybrid apps. So when it is a mobile web app, we can have the Selenium client, and we can be able to use the same code which was written for the web application. The same code will be useful for automating the mobile web application also. Though we don't require to write a new code, since the same code is applicable for mobile web app and web application. So we don't require APM client. We can directly use Selenium client to automate mobile web applications. APM client is specifically required for native or hybrid apps. So we have left at mobile application types, like a hybrid, native, or mobile web app. And then we will be looking into other automation frameworks that are available in the market, and what are the basic differences with them. And then what are the locator strategies that are available for native app. And then we'll be looking into the desired capabilities, which are the very basic, as is for Selenium, or similar to APM, similar to Selenium. The desired capabilities will be like, it will be specific to Android, or it will be specific to Windows, or it will be specific to iOS. So based on our device specific, platform specific, we'll be having desired capabilities separate to individual vendors. And then we'll be looking into the guide for installing APM, APM desktop client and APM, and then installing Android SDK. We'll be looking at the basic installation and setup, and then we'll be looking in looking into how to set up the Android Studio, and then how to debug using the debug using ADB devices. That we'll be looking at Android debug bridge, and then the commands which are available in the ADB. And then we'll be looking at into APM client installation, and what are the basic prerequisites before installing these things, like the Java and all those things we'll be looking at. So this is what we'll be covering as a part of APM initial setup. And once it was done, we'll be coming up with how to test a mobile app, native mobile app, and how to test a hybrid app, and how to test the mobile web application. So we'll be looking at what are the basic setups that are required for automating these three different types of applications, like the desired capabilities, are the options like Chrome options and all those things. And as I told, there are some difficulties. What are the difficulties over here with APM is like the initial setup is a difficult part. Once the initial setup is done, and then we are ready. It will be not so easy, but it will be okay. The initial setup is the hardest part over here. While coming to Android, it was a bit easy, but while coming to iOS device automation, it was a bit of tough thing to set up all these things, because to deal with automation, mobile automation using the real devices, we need to have iOS device in hand, which is costly, and also we need to have Xcode. So Xcode is like it's a IDE which is used for inspecting elements, or it is used for debugging and all those things. It is used for writing code for iOS devices actually. So Xcode will be installed. It can be installed only in iOS device. Mac OS, Mac based laptops only. So that's the problem. We need to have a separate MacBook or Mac related system, and then we need to have a device, iOS device, separately. So once these are available, only we'll be able to do automation on real devices. Otherwise, we need to go with we need to set up the Mac OS on a virtual machine, and then we need to download and install the Xcode, and then we need to start the simulator, and we need to execute our code on the simulators. So we cannot be able to do with real devices. So it's a costly part. And also to work with real, even though we have Mac OS and also a real device, iOS device available, the one more problem is like we need to have the developer related part, like we need to purchase access from Apple for $99 and yearly basis. So we need to have that. Only then we will be able to work on real devices. Otherwise, we will not be able to work on real devices. So in order to avoid all these things, what we can basically do is like we can set up a Mac OS on a virtual machine, and then we can download and install Xcode. Once that is done, we can simulate our automation scripts on a simulator. So this is a basic part we will be able to do. We will not be able to automate on a real device since we need to purchase the developer related license for $99 to automate or push the code. Basically, this why we need to purchase is like these things. Whatever we are writing the code, that code needs to be pushed into in a developer or Apple store or something. That will be validated by the Apple guys before pushing it into. Similarly, we will not be able to do any sort of this kind of things in Apple devices, because it is really very much secured. So they will not be allowed to do all these things unless we have purchased a license for that, for doing these activities, developed activities. So once you have purchased that thing, then you are free to do. Like it is like you will be trusting, you will be a trusted person, and then you will be able to do these kind of activities. So that's the very critical part, which is costly affair. So that's the reason we cannot go with those things. People who cannot go with all these things will be able to do on a, instead of a real device, they will be able to do it on a simulators. Similarly, Android doesn't have such things, because it is not having such things, because there is one more fact in between, like some specific files will be pushed on when the session is created between the APM server and the mobile device. What happens is like some specific files will be pushed onto the mobile, and those settings file and all those things will be available on the mobile. That will be pushed, allowed to push for Android devices, but due to the security reasons, iOS will not allow directly those things. So that is one more problem over here. So what I wanted to mention is like we'll be able to do automation using APM on real devices for Android, but not on for simulators. We'll not be able to show how to work on real devices on iOS. We'll be able to trigger those using simulators instead of our real device. So that's all. we'll go into APM introduction, brief introduction, and APM concepts in the next tutorial. Thank you guys.